So good afternoon to all the participants and welcome to the second webinar from the SILFID project. I am Amélie Drouot. I'm in charge of the business development activities at Arbium and also the coordinator of the SILFID project. So this 1 hour webinar will focus on the scale up of the wood to food process developed by Arbium. We'll focus especially on the achievements of the work done in the SILFID project on this scale-up activity. So this webinar is part of our final webinar series that includes three webinars where we will share the results of the project as regards to product performance. This occurred last week. Process performance, so this is today. And environmental performance of our process and product. This webinar will happen at the end of August this year. So today, our webinar will be presented by Charles-Henri Nicolas, who is the vice president of the demonstration program at Arbium. His presentation will be followed by a Q&A session. So to ask a question, please use the Q&A module available at the bottom of the window. The question will be sent directly to the panelists, and we will try to answer all the questions during the webinar, if time allows. Otherwise, we will follow up with you directly via email. So if you experience any difficulties to ask a question or any other matter, you can always use the chat to reach out to the panelists, and we will provide assistance. I also want to mention that this webinar is recorded. So before we jump into the specific webinar and Charles-Henri's presentation, we will share with you an introduction video that presents the SILFID project. Thank you all and have a good webinar.
SILFID is an international and multidisciplinary four-year project that is funded by the Bio-Based Industries Joint Undertaking. The project started in September 2017 and aims at scaling up Arbium's wood-to-food technology to convert wood residues into protein-rich feed ingredients comprised of single-cell proteins called SCP and test it into aquaculture applications. This project gathers 10 partners all along the value chain, from wood sourcing till fish feed manufacturing and testing, to address the European protein gap. The project will demonstrate Arbium's technology at large scale and also prepare for industrial scale-up.
At Arbium, our wood-to-food solution brings wood into the food chain. Unlike many of the other feedstocks being used for fermentation, wood is abundant for ester increasing, does not compete with food crops, and it's available year-round. It has robust and established supply chains. Our process technology has been validated in our lab and pilots, and thanks to the SILFID project, we are scaling it up to the demonstration level, getting ready to build our first commercial plants.
Arbium process converts wood into food in two main steps. First, wood residues are broken down into sugar-rich stream. Second, we perform a fermentation of the woody sugar to produce SILPRO, our protein-rich ingredient that our partners test for aquafeed application. Arbium process is being demonstrated thanks to the expertise and the facilities of Bioprocess Pilot Facility and Biobase Europe Pilot Plant.
The project includes the testing of the protein-rich ingredient for aquafeed applications. Matis receives batches of SILPRO to perform nutritional analysis, formulate feeds including this new protein source, and design small-scale and large-scale trials to test its effects on salmon and tilapia.
The SILFID project demonstrates a new value chain bridging the gap between forestry and aquaculture. It will expand the food production potential by valorizing a non-food resource and bringing it into the food chain.
Hello. Yes, so can you hear me okay? Working well? Okay, well, thanks for the kind introduction. I'm Jean-Laurent Nicolas. I'm glad to be here today and to present to you the results of a 4 years project of the Silphid project that has been aimed at developing and demonstrating at a wood to food process. This webinar is part of a webinar series, as Amélie mentioned, that was already completed, and the second one that will be given end of August, that I strongly invite you to participate to, that will provide more details about the life cycle analysis and environmental performance for our solution. So the project concept that we will talk about today is the wood to food project, the Silphid one, that is aimed at converting wood into food, as explained in the video. And in particular, we'll be focusing on the first part of it, of the wood fractionation and the bioconversion that converts wood sugars into a protein-rich ingredient, or SILPRO. As mentioned, if you're interested in the environmental performance of SILPRO and comparison to other sources of proteins, end of August, Andreas Brecker from Norsus will give a very enlightening webinar on this topic. So just a short company overview of Arbium. We are what we've done and where we stand. Arbium is a small company of 25 people, highly engaged and highly skilled in everything that is related to wood valorization or bio-based processes. We are located in France, in Paris, and in the US, in Durham, North Carolina. And we also receive strong support from industrial board, former vice president from IFPEN, National Institute on Petroleum and New Energies, and also from BP Biofuels. What we do at Arbium, what we've developed is a solution to answer or provide a solution to what's called today the protein gap, which is really a pressing and multidimensional challenge. We currently, at least in Europe, are importing 70% of our protein, and this is going to increase even further due to three main factors. The first one being the growth of population worldwide, a population that is also seeing its incomes rising, and significant development of a middle class that is generally accompanied with a change in the diet and the way people are feeding themselves, and in particular with a lot more of interest, all the aspects that are related to sustainability and health aspects of the wood. So all this together as for new source of proteins that are more affordable, more nutritional, that will also offer an unlimited and very large supply, avoiding any food scarcity, and that is more and more traceable. So our SILPRO ingredients actually provide answer to all these elements. It is nutritional, traceable, economical, and sustainable. It has a quite high protein content, over 60%, that facilitate also its inclusion in all the formulation for animal nutrition. It's highly digestible, meaning that it is way more converted into energetic value. It also contains some beta-glucan and MOS that provide benefits into the microbiota. Of course, it's economical. The solution we are proposing suffer less from price volatility of the sugar source, and instead wood prices are way more stable over time. and the wood is also providing more sustainability, in particular nutting with other food sources. Globally, when comparing our ingredients, Silpro, to other type of protein we currently find in the market or that we are seeing being developed worldwide, like insect, algae, or bacteria, Silpro provides several advantages on all the aspects we just mentioned. It has a low price volatility. It's competitive with fish meal in particular, which is the gold standard for aquaculture. And just as a reminder, Silfeed is really dedicated to aquaculture market. It has a high protein content and a high beta-glucan and MOS that improve the gut health, and we have track records on benefits for the microbiota. The utilization of wood is historically recorded, and wood has already a strong supply chain in place that offer a year-round supply of wood. It's also it has a higher digestibility, so it's really, really bioavailable, and also it does not compete with other food usage, as we are introducing a non-edible ingredient into the food chain. And of course, wood is the only and easily traceable biomass for which we have, and it already exists, certificates for sustainable management. So here, what I wanted to present is the complete picture of our innovative platform that contains two main parts, and in which we will dig into more details in the coming slides. The first one is really the wood fractionation, where we split the wood and its main component into three main elements. The first one being the hemicellulose that are then converted into soluble sugars. The cellulose, that is also through cellulose conditioning and enzymatic hydrolysis, converted into soluble glucose. And the lignin that is collected and valorized as a lignin-rich material for many applications. We'll get into it in the next slide. And the second part being the fermentation and downstream processing. It's producing the Silpro ingredient. That's our microorganisms that we grow on those woody sugars. This is a single cell protein for which we have a developed and selected the best candidate. Silfeed, in particular, is an integrated platform that goes and that covers the entire value chain from wood and forestry material down to the Silpro. Norske Skog, a large pulp and paper company for which Arbium has been working since 2014, has been working on the identification of the best forestry material, the best meaning the most available, that will not generate any competition or limited competition with current usages. That is also sourcing co-products to valorize the entire part or most of the plants. Then, with a couple of partners in the consortium, we've been developing solution to produce highly fermentable substrates rich in sugars that are then fermented into a protein-rich microorganism, prion, rice processum, BPF, and BBU, two open platforms with whom we worked for almost 3 years now, are clearly key partners on this part. And once Silpro was produced, we've been working with Matisse, that is an Icelandic research and development center, and Laxa and Skretting, that are two industrial player and manufacturer of fish feed ingredients. Norsus has been working with us all along the program to assess and to evaluate the life cycle impact to perform the life cycle analysis of the entire solution. Today, after all this development, from lab to bench to pilot and then the demonstration program, we are now ready for commercial dissemination. And I'll provide also in the coming slide a bit more detail as where we stand in terms of preparing our industrial deployment. We are confident to say that today we've reached a TRL-7 on most of our unit operation and in our integrated wood-to-food process. So now that you have a large picture of what we've been doing within the SILFI project, what I wanted to convey today through this webinar is a bit more info as what is process scale-up and demonstration. 4 years ago, when we submitted this answer to the call for proposal from the bio-based industry joint undertaking, we were just finishing the pilot phase and entering, and for us, it was time to enter a demonstration program. But what does that mean? What is it really you want to achieve when you're doing such a demonstration phase? So first, you have to clearly define what are your goals. You have technical goals first, and this is clearly the basis of what we're doing. I'll say this is in our genes, as we are mostly scientists, engineers, and technicians. So we want to, when you do your demonstration, you want to prove that your process is technically mature. You want to demonstrate that our technology can be deployed. You want to get confidence in your future industrial operation. And I think confidence is clearly a key word. You'll hear me saying that several times through the course of this webinar. Confidence in your operation, confidence in your stability, confidence in your product and the performance you will get. Then what's important technically, and that's also part of your goals, is to generate data for industrial plant design. Because once your demonstration will be performed, you should be in a position to start all the engineering phase for your industrial plant. So this data will feed all the FEL studies you will be performing then for the construction of your first commercial plant. So that's quite important. You generate data on which you are confident, again, and robust enough so you will design equipment that are probably worth millions of euros or millions of dollars. So you better be confident on this data. And then what you want to achieve also on a technical standpoint is to produce product, of course, at scale and on specs. You should not have quality default when going at larger scale. So you should absolutely achieve same performances, of course. This is because of your economics, but you should also absolutely achieve same product quality at large scale. And that's good. Once you have set those goals and you're clear on that, now you also have to consider that your demonstration must be commercial. So you need to provide sample to customer quickly because time is of essence. You're not alone in your field, and that's sure. The SILFID project, we were targeting aquaculture. This is a big market. There's a couple of players in this field. So we were aware that we are not alone, and going fast is also important because at the end you want to secure your customers. You want to secure your customers, and they most certainly already operate at industrial scale. So you have to provide them large scale sample. So you have to think big when you are doing your demonstration scale. You cannot being satisfied with lab scale or pilot scale samples. You have to provide industrially relevant quantities. Because at the end, and what will definitely justify the construction of your industrial plant, that you have letter of intent and offtake agreements on your product, so that the people who will invest in your technology or people who will invest in your industrial plant, they are confident that yes, they have markets, they have customers, and they will get revenue from these operations. So that's set your goals. This demonstration program, And this is what you have to achieve at the end of your program. So now, to do this, to achieve those, there are several strategies. You can either build your demo plant or leverage existing facilities. This is two different approaches that are both valid, but that contains pros and cons, and we'll get into it. Because building your demo plant, this is what you think you'll be doing, supervising activities of people, connecting plant together, but this is probably what you really be doing, and solving problem and issue, putting your hand on the mud and operating with probably good and bad days. So you have to have contingency plans, you have to have contingency budgets. You must hope for the best and prepare for the worst, because things may not occur as you think they will. Now, building your own demo plant, this is also how long it will take, you think it will take, but actually this is probably what it will actually take. Going from basis of design to FEL, going from FEL to engineering, then raising money, consolidating grants, starting up your plant, etc. It takes time, it takes more time than you think. And I think that 18 months is definitely a minimum of a demonstration program just for engineering and construction. So plan accordingly, plan forward. To my view, you should avoid retro scheduling and just think in terms of where is my starting point, where can I start? And then from there, just roll up your schedule all the way through completion. And here again, include contingencies. But now once demonstration is done, what you think will happen? You think you will have a demonstration platform, beautiful, fully operable with millions of dollars of equipment, and that people will line up to go to this open platform that you will transform, but that's probably what will happen. And I'm telling you, we've been through a couple of demonstration platforms that are today idle and that are sold pieces by pieces. So you have to think about that right at the start. How will you valorize your asset when you will have completed your demonstration program? Because you will enter this demonstration program for probably a year or two of operations once it will have been up and running. And so all this million invested will probably be worth valorized. Now, building your demo plant, it's also what you think it will cost, but that's what it will actually cost. Yeah, budget will be higher. You will start from your bench scale or pilot scale data. You will make a first estimation of your CapEx and OPEX, but at the end, you have to include contingency. You have to include it for real. Now, that was about building your own plan, but as mentioned, you can also leverage existing facilities and existing expertise too. So what you think you'll be doing is probably driving a super train or race horses going fast. But actually what you will really be doing is coordination and collaboration. Building pieces by pieces this puzzle of your demonstration program so that at the end you have accumulated enough data, enough confidence again, that your operation are sufficiently robust so that you can deploy it industrially. So going back to those two strategies and having a bit of a feedback on that, and if I can talk to you about that today, is because we've been exactly through that through the seed feed program. At first we thought of building our demo plant and we ended up leveraging existing facilities. For both there are a couple of pros and cons, and I think the two main ones that are really key drivers for two, and each project has its own specificity. So I'm sure that if tomorrow you're in a questioning about how to do your demonstration program, you will leverage those aspects. Cost is absolutely of essence, and your program will surely be in the range of 20 million or more. Just for, say, a short phase of demonstrating your technology. The second that is clearly of essence is the time. And while leveraging existing facility definitely provide the most expeditious path with platforms that are already up and running, with experienced people able to operate their plants, connected as it should, and you'll get support from this experienced team. So that's definitely key in the choice of what and how to do your demonstration program. What you have to be aware of is also that while going to facilities that are already up and running, we'll probably suffer availability and as we've been through the seed feed program, you will have dedicated campaigns and a limited amount of time actually operating the process. So that's a drawback that you have to consider too. So this is what we've been through with the seed feed project. We looked at open platforms where to operate our process. We've been through a long list of available facilities, among probably 10 various ones. We selected two that provided equipment, but also experienced people that gave a trust, that gave us the trust or the confidence again that we will achieve our goals. BPF, Bioprocess Facility in Delft in the Netherlands, they have this wood fractionation equipment that was suited to accommodate our technology. Of course, with some adjustments and adaptation, but the closest one to what we wanted to achieve. And then at BioBase Europe Pilot Plant in Ghent, in Belgium, they had the fermentation and teams to operate our fermentation steps and produce our Seal Pro, at least scale up our Seal Pro production to the next level. Of course, this is not all. We worked also with tons of equipment suppliers, various, from wood processing to filtration and washing and drying and centrifugation and powder conveying and engineering and all them. We work with them and they are key in your demonstration. They are key because these people, they will sell you tomorrow the equipment that will be operated industrially. So you need to be confident with them, with their technology. You need to be confident that their technology can provide the performances you want to achieve, not only at the demo level, but also at large scale level. So step by step, this is what we've done, and I'll come to the detail of it. So as mentioned, we have a first step of hemicellulose hydrolysis, and we went from a liter scale in batch, mapping all the hydrolysis yield and exhalanlasis to furfural, to continuous and stable operation in this industrial equipment, reproducing the same performances and identifying the best conditions to achieve our goals. And this, we are confident. So for us, this step is now approved. We reached the TRL7 and are confident enough to scale it up to industrial scale. Of course, there are still some questions about the operability and some recycling loops that we haven't been able to fully achieve and fully validate, but we have already contingency plans to demonstrate it further. From the previous step, we collect a cake that we filter, from which we recover the sugars, and we scale it up from the batch filtration to continuous and stable operations. We've implemented a vacuum bell filter, a representative one that processes more than 40 cubes of a slurry at a pace of 600 to 900 liters per hour, collecting more than 7 tons of final cake and sugar. So that's really representative operation. And from here, it's also approved, but not because of us, but because the supplier is also confident in scaling it up to industrial scale, confirming the stability and performances Being even more confident in the washing performances and water reduction at industrial scale. When it came to then cellulose preparation and enzymatic hydrolysis, we started with very small lab reactors, processing a few liters of material to ton scale hydrolysis with cellulose preparation and really purely stable operations through the processing of the cellulose and then reaching 8 to 24 cubes parallel hydrolysis, producing more than 3 tons of woody sugars for downstream fermentation. For each, what we've been achieving is also to compare what's happening with our process and various conditions compared to untreated material. And so now we're also confident reaching higher level of conversion. So here again, this is our confidence and we are taking responsibility for scaling it up. This is a basic agitated reactor. Now Arbium is taking responsibility for the scale up of this particular step. When it comes to lignin processing, after that, reproduction and repetition is key. So just on this very particular example, we reproduced 10 times the filtration to process all this, to process all the material, collecting at the end more than 1 ton of very dried product of lignin. And this filtration was here again, validated by another equipment supplier that was confident in scaling up the technology and actually getting even better performances at industrial scale than what he achieved in his own lab. So here, getting equipment quotation, validation, design, drawings even for this kind of equipment allows you to collect, generate data robust enough so that we get in a position for getting ready for industrial deployment. Once collected, the lignin was put into briquette in a, through a pelletization process and then tested in a combustion trials. Quite interesting, we saw a scheme of behavior of the lignin while burning like coal. So it's probably a very nice coal replacement solution. But there's still some development here and we'll get into it. But to get all this, we worked here again with an industrial equipment supplier that provided us a complete line for drying, pelletization, and cooling to have and process all this lignin into pellets at the end. So here again, that's even more confidence for us that yes, we have an industrially deployable solution. When it comes to fermentation, the conversion of our sugars into our SilPro, this is at the end what we really want to achieve. We went from 2 liter scale at lab, more than 15 cubes at BioBase Europe pilot plant. What we've been doing is to reproduce and run after run improve, capitalizing the knowledge from one run to another, and then optimize the recipe for the next run, and we repeated. And we repeated that 25 times. So that at the end, while in terms of stability and you could say convergence of all the runs, we are quite confident in the performances we can achieve. 126 days of continuous fermentation, 3,000 hours of fermentation accumulated. So this is more than the typical gold standards in the industry of 1,000 hours. We are more than confident that yes, this fermentation process can be deployed also providing the product on specs. We've been improving our yield run after run. So this is also what your demonstration program can provide, yield improvement, performance improvement since the start of the project. We build up also internal expertise and know-how. Our team is now confident. This is not just a matter of BBU being able to operate our fermentation. This is also us at Arbium knowing exactly our process, what is key, what are the indicators of a fermentation that goes right or that goes bad, what are the safety measures you have to put in place, what are the contingency plan, what if it goes bad, if you see contamination, what you can put in place to save the fermentation run, for instance, if we can say it this way, etc., etc. And it goes all the way through the downstream processing, how the product behaves, how it smells. This is something you cannot see or you cannot feel in a PowerPoint. So you have to be on site, you have to work with them. It's why I said at the start that you have to have your hands on. And on top of that, we are eager to even larger scale. So we actually perform some additional runs at 50 cubes and 180 cubes fermentation at various places, just also to provide even more product. Remember the think big aspect. Yes, customer want a product and they want a ton scale product. So now we are confident. We are not. Of course, we'll be purchasing fermenters. We'll be purchasing cooling equipment, agitator, etc. But we, Arbium, are confident in the reproducibility and stability of this. We are ready to take responsibility for its industrial deployment. And this is what actually really matters. And now at the end, at last but not least, commercial validation. The product that we've been producing, feed and food grade, and was constant. No matter what was the production site, we mentioned BBU, external facility, we've been also performing some drying at external places, and every time product was on spec, meaning that we know when it can go right, we've been identifying what element can make it go bad. So we now know also how to avoid that. And this is what really matters. Of course, this is not only internal validation. It's also external validation through external analysis by labs that are accredited for normative analysis. And of course, dissemination is key. We've disseminated the SILPRO in ton scale, more than 10 ton has been produced. We've disseminated that to 8 customers only on aquafeed and application through the SILFeed project. But we have also big demands, and we've seen traction for other markets, such as weanling pigs, such as pet food. And some were actually also quite interesting in putting that in as an ingredient for human food. But I think you'll hear about that in the coming months. And now, size matters because we received a request for more than 250 tons of SILPRO, meaning that yes, our product is raising attention and people are quite satisfied with it in inclusion. And we hope that we will find solution to quite such quantities in the coming months. But yes, we are confident, and this is still here again approved. 7 letters of intent signed, of tech agreements under discussion. We're really close to have that fully validated, because here, even if we are confident, now what we have to do is to convince investors to follow us in this industrial journey. Well, that's coming to an end and to a conclusion. This is Arbium's roadmap for the coming months. The SILFeed project is coming to an end, the end of this year. Our demonstration program has been validated through the process and product, producing ton quantities and satisfying customer demands, at least the initial ones. We have also validated a first design of an industrial plant, and we expect to deploy next year our first fermentation plant. This is already work in progress. We are looking for a site in France, of course, in Europe, because the market is here, targeting 10,000 tons of seal pro per year. We're still looking for the consolidation of the offtake agreement and to get further optimization benefiting from utilities we will find on site or even synergies with local partners. And then looking further 2024 and onwards with a commercial deployment, we consider dual business model with both direct operation and franchising. Of course, because we are ready to get involved directly in industrial operation because we are confident again in this, in our process and in our solution. But as a small and agile company, if any opportunity rise up for a franchising model, we are more than open to discuss that with any partner. Well, thanks to you for the attendance. Thanks to all the Silphid partners and to all the other ones that we met through this long journey since 2016. And I invite you to attend the next webinar series, August 31st, provided by Andreas Brecker, that will give more detail on the environmental performance of SILPRO and other proteins. If you have any question, please do not hesitate to come to us using the Q&A panel.